Hello everyone, in this video we will cover the section 6.3. In this section we will generalize the orthogonal projection onto a vector to any subspace in Rn. Given a vector y and a subspace W in Rn, there is a vector y hat in the subspace such that y hat is the unique vector in the subspace for which y minus y hat is orthogonal to the subspace, and y hat is the unique vector in the subspace closer to y. We can see from the figure. Actually, you know, in the section 6.2 we find orthogonal projection of the vector y onto some vector u in the vector space. The orthogonal projection of y onto the vector u is represented by y hat, and also we find the complement of this orthogonal projection, which is represented by z, and the angle between them is 90 degrees, namely y hat and z are orthogonal to each other, namely the inner product of them is equal to zero. Here we find the orthogonal projection of this vector onto some vector u in R cube or Rn. So we generalize this concept to any subspace. Instead of the vector u, actually it can be considered as a subspace which is spanned by the vector u. Namely, we can consider this vector as a subspace W by writing span u, because any multiple of u is the subspace passing through the origin. Okay. This actually can be considered as a line in the vector space. So instead of u, we take a plane, for example, in R cube or any subspace. Generally, we consider the vector space R cube. Okay. Instead of u, we consider the plane, as you can see, the green one, and we find the projection of this vector onto the subspace W, which is represented by y hat or proj WY. And also we find the complement of this subspace, which is z, namely z is orthogonal to the subspace. Okay, therefore y can be considered as the sum of these vector y hat and plus z, where y hat is an element of the subspace and z is an element of the complement of the subspace. If you remember the section 6.2 or 6.1. Okay. For example, this idea actually is particularly useful when u1, u2, blah blah, un is an orthogonal basis. This decomposition is very useful in applied science. For example, let u1, u2, u3, u4, u5 be an orthogonal basis for R to the 5, and let since it is an orthogonal basis, y is written as a linear combination of them, where the weights are c1, c2, blah blah, c5. So consider the subspace which is spanned by u1 and u2, and write the vector y as the sum of a vector z1 in the subspace and a vector z2 in its complement. Okay, we will write the vector y as the addition of two vectors z1 and z2. In the example, z1 should be in the subspace W and z2 should be in the complement of the subspace W, and W is a set spanned by the vectors u1 and u2, u1 and u2. So how can we write this vector like this one? And we have an orthogonal basis, and by taking the first two vectors u1 and u2, we create a subspace, and we want to write the given vector as the sum of a vector z1 and z2, respectively. Directly by using the representation written here, we can consider y as addition of two vectors z1 and z2, where z1 is the linear combination of u1 and u2, and z2 is the linear combination of the others. And since the subspace is a set spanned by u1 and u2, z1 is directly in this subspace, since it is a linear combination of them. According to the definition of the spanning set, this one is a vector in the subspace, and z2 is in the set spanned by the other vectors u3, u4 and u5. So we completed the first part of the question. We found a vector z1, which is the linear combination of the vectors u1 and u2, as you can see. And we should find z2. Namely, we should check that z2 is whether in the complement of the subspace or not. So how can we check? According to this definition, every vector taken from this subspace should be orthogonal to the vector z1. Okay. Namely, z2 should be perpendicular to the all vectors in the subspace. So how can we check? It is enough to take the vectors taken in the basis for the subspace. When we look at the definition of the subspace, directly a basis, since we have orthogonal basis for R to the 5, a basis for the subspace has the vectors u1 and u2, if you remember the definition of the spanning set. They are linearly independent because they are orthogonal. They are orthogonal, and every vector is a linear combination of them because of its definition. Therefore, it is a basis for the subspace. So it is enough to show that z2 is orthogonal to the vector u1, z2 is orthogonal to the vector u2, to show this fact, to complete the answer. So to see they are orthogonal, we take the inner product of them, z2 inner product u1, and z2 is the linear combination of the other vectors u1, u3, u4 and u5, dot product u1. And according to the property of the inner product, u1 is distributed over the parentheses, into the parentheses. So and all of them are orthogonal to each other, since we take at the beginning an orthogonal basis, which means that when we take any arbitrary pair from this set, so the vectors taken from here are orthogonal, since it is an orthogonal basis. Therefore, the inner product of them will be zero, the inner product of them will be zero, and the inner product of them will be zero. The sum of them will be zero, which means that these vectors z2 and u1 are orthogonal. U1 is orthogonal to z2. Similarly, you can show z2 is orthogonal u2, because when we take the inner product of them, u2 is equal to c3 u3 plus c4 u4 plus c5 u5 inner product u2. And by distributing u2 into the parentheses, according to the property of the inner product, u3 inner product u2 becomes 0, u4 inner product u2 is 0, and u5 inner product u2 is 0. Therefore, we have 0 for the inner product of z2 and u2, which means that z2 is orthogonal to the subspace which completes the answer of the question, because z2 is in the complement of the subspace, and we write the vector y as sum of two vectors which are orthogonal to each other. So the next theorem shows that the decomposition y is equal to z1 plus z2, namely z1 is z1 and z2 are orthogonal to each other, can be computed without having an orthogonal basis for Rn, because this is an example when we take an orthogonal basis in the vector space, but we don't need to have an orthogonal basis for Rn to write any vector as the sum of two vectors which are orthogonal to each other. It is enough to have an orthogonal basis only for the subspace, okay? So orthogonal, we have very important theorem here, which is called the orthogonal decomposition theorem. Let W be a subspace of Rn. W is a subspace of Rn, like the plane through the origin in R cube, for example. Then each y in Rn can be written uniquely in the form y hat plus z, like the previous section. Y hat is the orthogonal projection of the vector y onto the subspace, and z is the orthogonal complement. Namely, it is in orthogonal complement of the subspace V, and y hat is a vector in the subspace. It is an element of the subspace. You see the graph of this theoretical fact here. We take the orthogonal projection onto the subspace, which is drawn here, okay, y hat, and z is orthogonal to this subspace, which is found as y minus y hat, and y hat can be found by using the formula written here, okay? In fact, if we have orthogonal basis of the subspace, namely u1, u2, u3, blah blah, up, like the example, we have u1, u2 for the subspace W, like this one, if you have an orthogonal basis of the subspace, then y hat has the representation 2. It is written here, and z is found by applying the subtraction for y and y hat after finding the components of this vector. Okay, that's it. Just we should find an orthogonal basis for the subspace. Find an orthogonal basis for the subspace W, or it is given in the example. Sometimes, and find the components y hat by using the formula. Actually, this is the generalization of the formula y hat, which is the orthogonal projection of y onto some vector u. If you remember, it is found as y dot product u over u dot product u, and after finding this scalar, we take the multiple of this vector u by using this scalar. So the generalization of this concept to subspace is given here, okay, using the formula. And z is found as y minus y hat. Okay. So the vector y hat here, or this one, is called the orthogonal projection of y onto the subspace instead of the vector u in the previous section. Now we have a subspace, as you can see, and often is written as proj w y. Okay, as you can see in the figure, when w is one-dimensional subspace, the formula for y hat matches the formula given in the section 6.2, namely this one. Okay, this one, namely the general formula has the subspace. The general formula has the subspace, which is a set spanned by U1, U2, blah blah, UP. Okay, since these vectors are in the basis, it is an orthogonal basis. Therefore, this subspace can be considered as a set spanned by them. And if we have one-dimensional subspace, namely, we have only single vector here, let's say U, so the formula becomes this one. Therefore, the general formula matches the formula given in the previous section. You don't need to read the proof for preparing the final exam. For example, we have two vectors here, u1 and u2, and y has the components 1, 2, 3. Observe that u1, u2 is an orthogonal basis for the subspace span, for the subspace which is spanned by them. Okay. Namely, you can check easily, they are linearly independent. And they are orthogonal. Namely, the inner product of them should be 0, namely minus 4 plus 5 minus 1. So you see we have 0 for the inner product, which means that they are orthogonal and they are linearly independent. Therefore, it is an orthogonal basis for the subspace, and the second condition is automatically satisfied because every vector here is a linear combination of the vectors u1 and u2 because of the definition of the spanning set. Okay, the question is that write the vector y as the sum of a vector in the subspace and a vector orthogonal to this subspace. Okay, we should write y as y1 plus y2 such that y1 is in the subspace and y2 is in the complement. So we know directly a formula, namely y is written as y hat plus z. Y hat is in the subspace, namely we take the orthogonal projection of y onto the vector onto the subspace w by using the orthogonal decomposition theorem formula, and z is a vector and the complement of w, namely this is a vector orthogonal to the subspace. So from the decomposition theorem, we have directly a formula for y hat, and we have two vectors here. Therefore, the formula becomes this one, y inner product u1 over u1 inner product u1. The first part, as you can see, is actually the orthogonal projection of y onto the vector u1, and the second part is actually the orthogonal projection of y onto the vector u2, and the linear combination will be the orthogonal projection of y onto the subspace. Okay, from the formula, we need to find the inner product of y and u1, for example. So this is equal to 2, which is the multiplication of the first components. 5 times 2 becomes 10. minus 1 times 3 becomes minus 3. And from here we have 9, as you can see. And similarly, you can compute this inner product, which will be 30 and u1. And similarly, the inner product of y and u2 is 3. u2 inner product u2 is 6. And we write u2, the vector u2. And after necessary computation, as you can see, we find the components of y hat. Okay, y hat. So this is the orthogonal projection of y onto this subspace W, which is the set spanned by u1 and u2 in R cube. In R cube. Also, the vector z, you know, has the formula y minus y hat, and this one becomes 7 over 5, 0, 14 over 5, which are the components of the z, which is orthogonal to the subspace. And you can check y hat and z are orthogonal to each other. Minus 2 over 5, minus 2 over 5 times 7 over 5 becomes minus 14 over 5. 0 times 2 is 0. 14 over 5, actually we have 25 here. Minus 2 over 5 times 7 over 5 becomes minus 14 over 25. And the last one is the multiplication of the last components, namely 14 over 25, this one and this one. So the sum of them is 0, which means that they are orthogonal. They are orthogonal, and the addition of them, as you can see, give the vector y. Therefore, y is written as the sum of two vectors which are orthogonal to each other, and the first vector is an element of the subspace, the other is an element of the complement, orthogonal complement of the subspace. Okay, that's it. As I said, when we look at the geometric interpretation of the orthogonal projection, if you look at this one or this one, y hat is the addition of two projections, actually, two projections. The first one is actually the projection of u1, the projection of y onto the vector u1, and the second part is the projection of the vector y onto the vector u2. As you can see, y1 hat, y2 hat, and they are orthogonal. They are orthogonal. Namely, the orthogonal projection of y is the sum of its projections onto one-dimensional subspaces that are mutually orthogonal. This is the geometric interpretation of this orthogonal projection in R cube, for example. Okay, because u1 and u2 are orthogonal, we take orthogonal basis for the subspace. Since u1 and u2 are orthogonal, so the orthogonal projections onto these vectors also are orthogonal to each other. Orthogonal to each other. Therefore, this vector and this one, the first part and the second part, namely y1 hat and y2 hat, are orthogonal actually to each other. Namely, the inner product of them is zero. It is zero. This is very important in geometry. And here we have another important theorem, which is called the best approximation theorem. This theorem says that let W be a subspace of Rn. Again, we take a subspace, and we take any vector in Rn, and we can find the orthogonal complement, orthogonal projection of Y onto the subspace, and we conclude that the terminal point of this vector, or directly we can say Y hat, is the closest point in the subspace to Y, namely to find the distance from the vector Y, between the vector Y and the subspace, it is enough to find the distance between the vector Y and its orthogonal projection onto the subspace. This gives the closest distance. Okay. And theoretically, we write the norm, actually, namely the distance, the norm of the subtraction of Y and Y hat is always less than the distance between the vector Y and any vector V in the subspace W. This is the smallest one, smallest value. Okay, so the vector Y hat in this theorem, in the best approximation theorem, is called the best approximation to Y by elements of the subspace to find the smallest distance from the vector Y and subspace. So we need to find its orthogonal projection Y hat, and we compute the distance between them, and it gives the best approximation. Best approximation for the vector Y and the subspace W. Okay. This theorem explains this important application, the best approximation. For example, in the previous example, we saw the vectors U1 and U2 and the vector Y, and we know the subspace W, which is the set spanned by U1 and U2. So the closest point in the subspace to Y, namely the smallest distance between the point gives the smallest distance between Y and the subspace, is the terminal point of Y hat, which is the orthogonal projection of Y onto the subspace W. And using the orthogonal decomposition theorem, directly we find the components just by calculating this addition, this sum, and we calculated in the previous example, you know. So the closest point to the vector Y in the subspace has components written here, -2/5 to 1/5. Another example: the distance from a point Y in Rn to a subspace W is defined as the distance from Y to the nearest point in the W, nearest point. And we know the closest nearest point, which will be Y hat, the orthogonal projection of Y onto the subspace W. Okay, find the distance from Y. Let's say this is the vector Y and this is the subspace. What is the distance between them, the subspace and vector Y, and vector Y and the subspace W, where W is the set spanned by U1 and U2. We have different vectors here, U1 and U2. 5 minus 2, 1, 1, 2, minus 1. And U1 and U2 should be orthogonal, and as you can see easily, they are orthogonal, which means that the orthogonal basis for the subspace has the vectors U1 and U2. And automatically we have the second condition, namely every vector is the linear combination of them because of the definition of the spanning set. Therefore, it is an orthogonal basis. Our aim is to find the distance between them because the distance is defined as the distance from Y to the closest point, and the closest point is the terminal point of the orthogonal projection of Y onto the subspace. Namely, we should find the orthogonal projection Y hat, and by using the decomposition theorem, orthogonal decomposition theorem, again we have two vectors, we use the formula orthogonal according to the orthogonal decomposition theorem, Y dot product U1. So we have two vectors, therefore we will have two parts in the addition, two terms plus Y dot product U2 over U2 dot product U2. The first term is the orthogonal projection of Y onto the vector U1. The second one is the orthogonal projection of Y onto the vector U2, and the linear combination of them is the orthogonal projection of Y onto the subspace W, which is the set by span by U1 and U2. And after the necessary calculations written here, namely Y dot product U1 should be 15, we can check, minus 5, which is the multiplication of the first component, plus 10, 20 minus 5 becomes 15, as you can see. Similarly, you can find dot product of U1 by itself, which is 30, minus 21 and 6, the others. And we write U1 and U2 here, and we find the orthogonal projection. And Y minus Y hat is the orthogonal complement. And the distance the distance from the vector Y to the subspace is the norm Y minus Y hat, which is equal to square root of, if you remember, Y minus Y hat has the components written here, 0 square root, which is equal to 0, 9 plus 36, which is square root of 45, which is equal to 3 square root of 5. Okay, just we find the norm of this subtraction, okay, which is actually the vector z. Just we find actually the norm of the vector z, okay. And that's, you don't need to read the last theorem here. It is enough to learn these things from the section 6.3. Thank you very much.